Good morning and welcome to this sunrise safari. A very cloudy morning it is, but an exciting morning. There were mating leopards around, and thanks to Lucy, Kevin, Catfish and many others who let us know and spotted them on the Juma cam. So a very important question, guys, is which way did they go from the Juma cam? So if we have a look now, we are on the dam wall, and Vim's going to show you where the cam is. Did they go towards the lodge? Did they go towards the dam wall? Would they go behind the camera, or did they go straight north opposite the camera? So if you can let me know which way they went, hopefully we can find them for you. So we're gonna, while you guys let me know which way they went, I'm gonna do a big loop around this area, see if we can find any tracks. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have VM on camera. We have Jamie and Brian on the other vehicle. And we have Kirsten and Rebecca in final control. So the cloud we're experiencing at the moment, I think is gonna break up. As you can see already, there's some gaps in it. Oh, hang on, those guinea fowl alarm calling. Well, they're just shouting for the joy of morning. I think they're just shouting for the joy of morning. Yes, definitely not alarm calling. Make sure those leopards didn't wander east. So with mating leopards, the nice thing about them is they're quite noisy, so that makes them a little bit easier to find. Thanks very much, Shelly. They drank at the pan and went left towards the lodge, so we're on the right track. Now, hopefully they haven't meandered too far, and shortly the dawn will be broken by the sound of mating leopards. One slight negative is they were drinking at 3:30 in the morning, so that means they could have put some distance between themselves and the pan. So we will try our best to relocate them. Chris says, oh my God, it's not dark anymore at the beginning of drive. And that is correct. We have changed. We are going out slightly later as we move into the winter months or dry season. So very observant of you, Chris. And before the end, hang on, what's that now? No, that's a hyena. And before the end of winter, strange enough, we will be going out in the dark again as changes. Now, till the winter solstice, we'll be getting light later and later, until that turning point where it'll start getting light earlier and earlier again. Well, we're in search of these leopards. Let's jump on board with Gemma, so she can bid you a wonderful morning.
A very good morning to all of you, and welcome to our sunrise safari. For those of you meeting us for the first time, my name is Jamie, and I have Brian on camera with me this morning, and we're also assisting in the search for these mating leopards. Yet, for those of you who were watching the sunset safari yesterday, I made a promise that I would go straight back to the hyena den that was reported to be active and double check and see, since we haven't seen our hyena cubs and our hyena clan members in quite a considerable period of time. I did go and check, and it wasn't active. There were no cubs about. There was one hyena that was already in the process of disappearing off into the bushes in a spot that was impossible to follow. So I'm not quite sure what's going on with our hyenas. I don't know if they're switching between dens every night around Aubrey's Road. They were reported to be active in the den site that we've seen them in relatively regularly over the last 10 days. This morning they were just around. So we have changed our route plan. I'm now heading back towards, or I'm coming from the northern side of the Juma Dam. So Brent from the south, I'm checking to the north. Those leopards were seen at 3:30 this morning, which has given them a good 2.5 hours to, or almost 2.5 hours, to wander off somewhere different. I'm going to take hazard a guess as to where they might be and check along the drainage lines around the lodge. I've made one tiny error in judgment this morning, and that was the temperature, because I'm currently in the process of becoming hypothermic. That might be a slight exaggeration, but I'm definitely chillier than I was when I set off this morning. There you go, that's better. It's one of those cool, cloudy mornings that started off warm and is now exceptionally chilly. Lucy, you've sent through the update about which way the leopards went. You're saying that they went towards the lodge and then south-southwest from there. Well, thank you, Lucy, for that update. I'm just going to double-check before I go and check around Galago Pan. I'm just going to double-check the access road. I drove it earlier this morning, but it was still slightly dark, so it could be that I missed their tracks wandering across there. And now it's just a guessing game as to which way Tingana decided to go. And it is, with mating leopards, it is essentially the male that decides when he's going to move about, and the female follows along with him, which is why you find situations like this where Tundi, Karula's daughter, is sitting right in the middle of, right in the heart of Karula's territory. They were seen mating as an issue for major concern. Neither Tingana's not a threat to Karula's cubs. He's probably, or at least he could be, the father. And so far has been so good. He hasn't lived up to maybe an unfair reputation that he's been given. And Tundi, as Karula's daughter, will also not be interested in hassling Karula or her cubs. Although I can't imagine that Karula was terribly impressed with the state of affairs. She certainly wasn't the last time that happened. I'm sorry, guys. I'm just listening to the game drive comms with Half and here. James out on tracking team now to help us follow up on the mating leopards. We've seen Tundi mating with Tingana 3 times in the last few weeks, 3 different sessions. This is the 3rd now. And it's obviously, she hasn't fallen pregnant the 1st 2 times. But if this particular time is successful, Teresa, you were wondering about how long the gestation period is for a leopard. Oh, somebody's looking very sleepy. Good morning. Sorry, Teresa, I'll be with you in 1 second. Oh, so deeply asleep he hasn't even lifted his head. Oh, there we go. Morning, sorry. It's okay. You carry on your nap. Don't mind us. Fair enough. Whites of my eye. Whites of his eye.
morning.
Now, this is quite a common approach of the animals in the early morning when it's a cool, cloudy morning like this. They tend to stay sleeping for a little bit longer. He looks terribly comfortable lying where he is, not even ruminating. And just have a quick look at that ox picker that's sitting on him. Now, that is a red-billed ox picker, minus the red bull. It's actually a juvenile, it's still a youngster. So that bull in the process of changing from black to red. You can really see the way that this ox picker is sitting. You can really see those. Oh, yes, feed me. Never mind that I'm sitting on my own buffet. Please feed me. Isn't that interesting? That little interaction. Begging, constant begging. You would think that he would have plenty of access to food to get himself, and yet still reliant on mom and dad to feed him. Ah, look at that, the search for the leopards collides. Morning. I haven't seen any tracks coming. Haven't seen any tracks coming this way.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe I've missed something on an access road crossing. Okay. Brent casually and very gently blinding us with his light still on to help him spot tracks. But yes, that little interaction was really interesting between juvenile and mom and dad. The whole life cycle played out on the backs of buffalo and giraffe and impala. He's up, sort of, having a good chew. Does his right eye look a little bit bulging? That's interesting. I wonder if it's just the angle that it's at or if he's had some kind of injury to it. Fascinated by this ox picker as well. I mean, it looks like it wants to feed itself. You would think it would be a very easy thing to do on the back of a buffalo. But that serrated beak that ox pickers have, obviously this juvenile hasn't fully learned to use it. And the way that ox pickers pull ticks off buffalo, because it's actually quite difficult to dislodge a tick. It's not an easy thing. Their mandibles manage to dig into the skin of the animal and clasp tight. So it takes quite a fair amount of force to pluck them off. The ox pickers comb their beaks through the fur of the animal to pull them off. We have a question from Rebecca about why ox pickers' beaks turn red. And the answer is it's the species type. There's two different species of ox picker. This is the most common of them, the red-billed ox picker. There was also an ox picker that has recently done an amazing recovery in terms of species number, which is the yellow-billed ox picker, which has a half yellow, half red beak, and almost became extinct in this area until some seriously concerted efforts of various conservationists managed to pull it together and help to rehabilitate their numbers. But the red-billed ox picker is the most common. I'm just listening. Sorry, I'm just listening to James's updates as well. But Rebecca, why then? Why does this animal have either a yellow or a red bull? What is it that confers that advantage? And the answer is I don't know. With color in birds, it's almost always a reproductive tactic. So birds take one of two approaches. One is the subtle coloring of the Franklins, the sort of the more camouflage-oriented approach, and then you get the bright-colored lilac-breasted rollers, kingfishers, which go for the incredibly beautiful plumage. And there's no real complete explanation as to why it is that they do that color. Most theories seem to converge around the idea that it is a reproductive advantage and that the better, brighter colors communicate well to prospective mates. buffalo looking intently at me, perhaps learning something about the colours of oxpecker's bulls. Probably not, though. I think he's just quite happily chewing on his cud. Okay, buffalo, I'm sorry, we need to leave you. We need to go and find those leopards. Let's jump on the back with Brent and find out how his tracking's going.
So no tracks yet. It seems like they've done a disappearing maneuver. But don't worry, we're on it. And Commander Bond is out on the tracking team, giving us a hand. So if we think about Tingana and Tingana's territory and Tingana's normal routes, because you must remember, she's going to be following him. And he's come in from the west. So I'm thinking he might head east. So they came down here last night. And now I think this is before you guys would have seen them on the Juma camp. So I'm going to ignore these tracks for now. And then wherever they've gone from the pad, they've decided not to use the road. 1 second.
Daisy, and it seems as though Brent disappeared off your screen. Just one of those slightly more dodgy signal patches, apparently, that he's got to go and check for. Okay, let me think. You just caught me in the middle of trying to rack my brains around where is best to search, since Brent has already checked around the Galago Pan area. I still have a funny feeling they might be in those drainage lines there. But before I act on that assumption, I'm just going to check more carefully around the drainage lines. They might have gone, as we had that update from Lucy, they might have gone south-southwest and done the leopard thing and gone north-northeast. You know how leopards do. Snuck around the back of the camera and popped out somewhere else. And since both Brent and James are very thoroughly checking the area to the south of me, I'm going to head north and just check around there, just in case they have pulled a sneaky leopard maneuver on us. We have been so incredibly fortunate with leopard sightings over the past few weeks. And so many of them have been centered around where I am now, which is essentially our home. You know, that's right around our camps, right around this quarantine clearings area. We're definitely exceptionally fortunate in the area that we are in. On Juma.
Which route are you checking?
Just making sure that we don't end up checking in the same place.
Okay.
The difficulty here now, of course, is that the hyenas have been, despite the fact that they don't seem to want to appear on camera and they don't want to come out of their dens, they have been exceptionally active, and there's tracks crisscrossing all over the show. And once vehicle traffic starts to increase, it gets harder and harder to distinguish when you're just looking at the sort of the curve of a back pad or the curve of a toe. Right, let's go back to where they were last seen. Just wondering perhaps if this chilly weather hasn't played a role in keeping the hyenas in their den for at least this morning. But John, on the subject of hyenas, you were wondering, could it be that the hyenas don't like all of the traffic around their den, and that might be why they have moved? John, I don't think so. I mean, it's a possibility, But judging by the way that the animals react, the adults barely pay us any attention at all, and the cubs actually appear to enjoy having the company of the vehicle sometimes. It provides a nice little distraction from their day-to-day boredom when they get tired of playing with each other and chewing on sticks.
I'm busy checking now. I'm not sure where they've gone from the bank.
Then our tires are quite a useful distraction. Sorry, I'm just listening to the tracking updates. I heard a squirrel alarm calling, but it's alarm calling at a Wahlberg's eagle. Awesome. Thanks, Brian. See that very, very square tail? Here it goes. And the squirrel chattering away in response. Awesome. Well done, Brian.
Yeah, I'm not sure how it's check where the bonds are crossing from here.
Okay. Brent has once again crossed our path, or we've crossed our path with Brent. So we're going to leave him to check these tracks. We'll go check the western side of quarantine. I thought he was a little bit further south than he was. Try and coordinate this a little bit better. Oh. Now, Taxon's just said he thinks he's got the tracks coming up onto quarantine. So perhaps it might even be worth going to check the western edge around Zoe's road. Now Brent is wandering around Juba Dam, trying to figure out the direction of the last tracks. I'm going to follow Lucy's update and guess that they're going to pop out somewhere around here. Teresa, I'm very sorry. I don't think I answered your question on gestation periods of leopards. I got completely distracted by the buffalo. And I'm not sure if Brent did either. Probably not. Sorry, Teresa. I was right in the middle of answering it. So, Teresa, first of all, you wanted to know about gestation periods of leopards, and we spoke that if this mating is successful, we'll have roughly 3 months between 95 and 100 days. Maybe even 90 days, depending. It differs from area to area and from individual leopard to individual leopard, just like within women. It can differ by a couple of weeks over or sooner than 9 months. So it's about 3 months that we will have to wait for cubs to make an appearance. But we are so fortunate in that both Karula and her daughter Shadow, Tandi's sister, both have cubs. And that actually brings me to my next question, which was also from Teresa, about how many leopards there are in the area that we track. And Teresa, the answer is, let's just list them by name. Karula, of course, being, I would say, our main character. This is the center of her territory. And she is the mother of Shadow, who lives next door, sort of, if you can put it that way. She has the territory adjacent to Karula. Tandi, her other daughter, who also has the territory adjacent to her. We've also got Tingana, the main dominant male leopard that we see. We could see Mbula, who's recently become something of a nomad. He's got to the age where he's just that little bit too old to keep defending a territory. We have the Anderson male on the odd occasion, right towards the western fringes of our boundary, and one of the biggest leopards the Sabi Sands has ever seen. We could see Quarantine and Kunuma, although they seem to have dispersed quite far to the south now. Those are Karula's two sons. There's also now a mystery male that's been nicknamed Gijima. So that's 9 so far. There's also always the possibility of other leopards wandering in. As I said, with Tingana mating with them, he will draw them in to territories outside of their normal home ranges and boundaries. So that's them. Once we expand to Cheetah Plains, we could see Inkanyeni and her two cubs. And then there's a couple of others that might make an appearance. Leopards, whilst they have home ranges, they have sort of strict territories that they defend, they have larger home ranges, and they do occasionally wander into each other's territories. There's a very large degree of overlap. So, for example, Shimbambalan could come along here. We could get a totally unknown leopard from anywhere in the area. Unfortunately, we did see another female leopard known as Quetile. But it seems as though, I mean, it's never been 100% confirmed, but she hasn't been seen since the last sighting of her where she looked exceptionally ill. Suspected snake bite, but we probably will never know exactly what happened to her. And then there's also the possibility of Saleeshe. Now, Saleeshe is a very large female leopard that lives to the west of our boundary. Her female cub has just turned, or is close to 1 year old now, and apparently at 9 months old took down a fully grown impala by itself. So she apparently could well be carrying the Anderson male's genes. Nice large size leopard. And we might find that she decides, or I'd really like to hope, that she decides once she establishes her territory, that she decides to establish it sort of between her mother's and Shadow's, which would be wonderful. But those are our predominant leopard characters at the moment. That could always change. The wildlife is in a constant state of flux.
The last one I can see from the pan goes straight up towards Yuri's pan.
One of the best ways to find mating leopards, and I'm concentrating quite hard on not missing their tracks coming through here. One of the best ways to find a mating leopard pair is to listen. Now, it's not a quiet act. There's a great deal of growling and snarling that happens when leopards mate, both from the female and from the male, although it's the male that makes most of the noise. That could be how we end up finding them this morning, by just stopping and listening. One of the reasons why I stopped at that buffalo was just to have a chance to sit and listen. It also should carry fairly well. The only problem is that the wind is blowing. So if we're on the wrong side of the sound, the wind might actually blow it away from us. Brent said his last set of tracks were heading straight towards Yuri's house, so to the west of the Juma Dam. Let's find out. Let's get that update straight from him.
So we're just trying to figure out where these leopards could have gone. And these tracks are now heading almost directly to Final Control. Stay on them for a while. I do apologize if my head's hanging off the side. But we are trying to find you a mating pair of leopards. So I've got both the male and female tracks going through here now. Now, it looks like Karula is also trailing them, so there's three different leopards from the tracks that I can see. See if they've gone down the edge of the fence of the lodges, or they've carried on up the access road.
You are back once again on the back of Wendy. Wendy proving to be the old reliable this morning. Hopefully you managed to hear enough from Wendy to get the update on his plans and where he's going to go. I think I want to go all the way to the western corner of quarantine and then sit and listen. Let's try that tactic, because this driving around thing is clearly not working out for us, or at least not yet. Might be worth it. I just wish the wind wasn't howling quite so much. It was making life a bit more difficult. Now, this drainage line is also a very, very popular leopard spot. And on this particular patch of soil on quarantine, it could be very easy to miss their tracks going in there. This is where our ears are going to play a good role. See if we can't find a bird to stop and look at, so that I can stop and listen. Keep your eyes peeled. You never know, one day we're going to have a situation where one of the viewers spots something before we do. I challenge you all to see the leopards before we do. Certainly, I've had plenty of occasions where the cameramen have spotted them before I have.
I'll see you, Connie. They went west from Bush.
There we go.
Okay, could we close? Show us what time?
Aubrey's found the tracks coming straight towards us. I'm just checking along this part of the road. I don't think they've walked down here.
We'll try to come around that side there. There's no one there. I've crossed. It's so slow that I've been
in there. I'm just listening to the taxon, so maybe our guess about the drainage line was spot on.
Okay. Yeah, maybe check, Finn's road that side.
Okay.
Right.
Aubrey's checking that side.
I copy Aubrey. I think you put on the
Let's go back along this road. They're somewhere here. I'm sure they're in this drainage line. Taxon's checked all the way towards the west. So towards the western side on the other side of this drainage line. So they're somewhere in this block. And now it's just a matter of hearing them or figuring out exactly which way they've gone. Backwards and forwards, it's all a question of patience at this point. Plenty of patience and just double checking oneself as you go along. The problem with a cloudy day like today is that the light doesn't make it terribly easy for us to see tracks. Without the sunlight sort of hitting the ridges of the tracks in the sand at the right angle, everything becomes flat. I could describe it like that. It's very flat like that. It's very flat light. But it does look as though it might be clearing soon, which will make our jobs even easier. Come on, you two. Leopards. You must be here somewhere. Well, at least we've established a direction at this point, where they went from the dam. One of the things that we do whenever we do find the leopards, if we are sitting with them and we see them defecate, or if we find leopard scat in an area where we know which particular leopard is moving about there, we pick it up very carefully with gloves or sticks without touching it, and we put it in a test tube, and we send that test tube across to Panthera. What Panthera is busy doing is conducting an enormous, I mean truly enormous, study into testing the genetics of leopard, and in particular focusing on paternity of leopard cubs and trying to figure out just how many cubs are actually fathered by dominant male leopards in an area and how many are fathered from outside. And I mean the ramifications of that are, first of all, they're enormous in terms of the leopard dynamics. But also it really gives you an idea by genetic analysis of just how far a male leopard has come and dispersed from. Now, some of the leopards in this area we know very, very well. They've been tracked from birth. But others, like Gijima, for example, to analyze his DNA would be fascinating. We could find that he emerged from somewhere completely far away from where we are now. And Paul, you were wondering, since you saw, or you watched one of the safaris where we put Tingana's feces into a test tube, you were wondering if we've got any of the results back yet. The answer is no, we haven't. Sorry, I just need to listen to this. My game drive comes off fairly soft.
Oh, do you got that, sir? Bob, I've got that in Konzo. It comes out of twin dams. It goes to the pan in front of Wiatela and then goes through between Yurikaya and Wiatela and then sort of cuts southwest onto quarantine.
I hope they're not sitting in the middle of quarantine and we're all five of us have just been driving circles around them and not noticing. That would be terribly embarrassing.
I'll go back and check those tracks. Last tracks I had were between...
Sorry, Paul. The answer is no. We haven't... Oh, goodness. Oh, dear. How does he manage that? I thought he was around quarantine. I know. He's got portals. I mean, really? Okay. I'm not going back on myself again. I'm not doing it. I'm going this way. I'm busy sitting listening, which is in the exact spot that I was going to go and sit and listen. So at least I know that we have very similar plans. Good thing we've checked everywhere. At least we know that we're double, triple checking each other, whether we want to or not. Paul, it takes quite a long time for those genetic testing results to come through. And you'll probably find that they're going to hold off on sharing that information with us until the study is complete, or at least until it is partially complete. But I promise you, as soon as we do know any results, we will let you know. Morning. I'm deliberately trying to check where you're not checking.
Apparently we've got a gremlin. We're still black screen.
Yes, I know. I hear so.
We're not sure why. The tech department is on it.
Okay.
But we might have to go visit them. In a personal capacity shortly.
Aha, all right. Morning, Liam.
We're going to try to find these leopards before we...
Yes.
...run back.
Disappear off. Isn't
it? Going everywhere.
Liam's beard is terribly impressive.
It is.
Oh, very nice.
All right, I'm going to keep trying to dodge you unsuccessfully.
So these tracks are going everywhere. I mean, there's tracks going east, west, north, south. James has been listening. He hasn't heard anything. I haven't heard anything.
Yeah, Tax has checked around Balanites Junction, so...
Yeah, there's no tracks going there. Last tracks are between FC and Huatello.
Okay. All right, let's continue on. See if we can't figure out which way they've gone. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Enjoy your sitting and listening.
Guys.
Cheers. All right, shall we try and pick a different route to the one Brent's going to take? I have a feeling I'm going to go around the corner and you're somehow going to be there in front of me. If I were the leopards, which way would I go? Oh, it's an impossible question. How many is that? There's five of us looking for these leopards. So we are going to find them. If they can be found, we are going to find them. There's Taxon and Aubrey from Vuyatela and Galago, plus their trackers. And then there's James, Brent, and myself all looking as well. Plus, of course, our incredibly eagle-eyed cameraman to assist us. But we really should be able to find them. What do you think, Brian? Race Brent to find them.
Yes.
I think that's a good idea. Let's see if we can't figure this out before Brent does. Question is, who's going to find them first? Would it be A, Taxon, B. Horbury, C. James, D. Brent, or E. myself? Now that is the serious question. These are the pressing concerns that haunt us first thing in the morning. Sorry, I'll be with you in 1 second. Standing by.
Where are you heading from where I saw you?
I'm going to take Finn's Road. I'll check along there.
Copy, I'm going to take a gander and access a little further away since I haven't heard anything yet.
Copy, I think that's quite a good idea. There's a good chance I missed them on my way up this morning. Please, please don't let me have missed those tracks this morning. I'll never hear the end of it. I was concentrating, so I shouldn't have, but it was dark and it is cloudy and it is windy, so I might have. On the subject of the weather, Candy, in Memphis, you were wondering, how does the windy weather affect the animals? Is it better? Is it worse? Is it good for hunting? The answer is this kind of wind is really useful to predators for hunting. It unsettles the general game, so the prey animals that are potential prey species tremendously. They can't hear properly because there's constant rustling, the wind is blowing sound away or sound towards them, they can't quite gauge distance from where the wind is coming from. And it also blows or messes with their sense of smell. So it blows scents away from them. It's really easy for a predator to pick a spot downwind and creep up slowly. So for predators, it is of a tremendous advantage. For the general game species, it's terribly unsettling. And you'll see it with almost all animals, including the predators. Even they are a little bit unsettled in windy weather, just because although it's easier for them to hunt, it does also carry the same disadvantages in that it's easier for example, if they're a leopard, it'd be easier for a lion to sneak up on them, for example, or just to bump into them. Since their senses are robbed a little bit of their potency. You'll find with antelope, buffalo maybe a bit less so, although the breeding herds get very unsettled in this weather, and elephants especially seem to get upset when it's windy. And I don't know, I've found that with human beings as well. Personally, and it's not every person, but personally, I find myself just that little bit more restless when there's wind howling, when there's particularly strong wind. I get, not nervous, just restless, I think is the best description, antsy. Like I want to constantly be moving. And I don't know if that's just my personality type, or if perhaps it is to do with ancient instincts telling us that windy days are dangerous. Who knows? Let's find out if Brent has any opinion on that particular subject.
So it looks like we've beaten the gremlin with a stick. As you can see, my stick is extended for whacking gremlins as they pop their heads up. But we have defeated the gremlin, but so far the leopards are winning the battle of the tracks. So we have five people looking for these leopards at the moment, and we're not sure where they've gone. So there's a lot of people checking close around the lodge, so just in case they've headed a bit further out, I'm going to head. Jamie has tracks just to the south of us. So we're gonna loop round further away and try to jump ahead of them. Sorry, just listening to the Game Drive channel. So well done, Jamie. So clever. Gonna chat on the Gandalf channel quickly. So we're
one would hope, between all of us.
Jamie's heard them. Okay, Jamie's got audio, so we're gonna loop around and see if we can help. Although there's a lot of cars there, maybe we should go look for lions. What do you think, Vim?
You can find that male lion coming past the van.
Yes, but that was from yesterday. We tracked those yesterday.
Fair enough.
Former girls could come back. So if Jamie's got audio and she's got Tax and Aubrey right there, it's probably not the best idea for us to also zoom around there. And so we're going to move off a little bit, see if we can find something else. So Scott on Twitter says, go find the bee boys. Well, if we find any tracks, Scott, we certainly shall try. Unfortunately, I think they are outside of our traverse at the moment. But you never know, they might have meandered back overnight. This cloud was going to break up, and it started to. And then it looks like this grey bank is rolling in from the west. Now, I don't think we're going to get any rain off that. It's sort of a very dry at the moment. There's no humidity in the air. Sorry, Tax, go again. Copy, thanks. So we're having a look here. Sorry about that, I was just on the radio. There's a lot of birds in these little grey bushes at the moment. They are fruiting. You can see the hornbills are having a feast over there. Look at them picking the berries. Ooh, look out. Vim, are you hungry?
I got fruits.
Vim's got fruits. I might go wait for those hornbills to finish eating and go pick a gwarri berry or two. They're very sweet and tasty. Oh, hornbills are gone. So let's go have a look. So one of the most amazing things about certain of the fruiting trees around here is that as we get closer to this bush, so we'll have a look here. So they will become ripe at different times to ensure that, so you can see there's lots of different colors and various stages of ripeness. So to ensure that they get spread and not all the fruit is wasted, they will become ripe at different times. So there will be a constant feeding for a prolonged period on the bush. But gwarri fruit is quite nice. There's another one here. Are you sure you don't want to try?
Give myself.
If the hornbills know what they're doing. There we go. There you go, Vim. I want to try. So it's really sweet. Yeah, this is a slight tannish taste, but really, really yummy. Oh, that one's got a worm. Vim, I think we should spend our drive here eating gwarri seeds. What do you think?
You like breakfast.
It's breakfast. So, let me just... Now, So not only will birds, there we go, that's the seed. It looks like a big solid thing. All right, this one. There we go, that one I've taken the skin off. And you can see it's actually got a split down the middle. So it's actually two seeds inside a single fruit. And not only, well, birds are not the only lovers of the guari. People love the guari. And also civet, genet, monkeys, baboons. Now, you don't find many of the antelope going for the fruit species. It seems to be far more the omnivores than the birds. And very few of the animals will actually even eat guari leaves. So they're not really, really tasty in comparison to the seed, in my opinion. So if we try a leaf, very high in tannins. Like literally numbs and dries your whole mouth. Oh, I need fruit to replace that terrible taste. So I'm just gonna pick a few, we're gonna move on shortly, but and take a few snacks for the road. So we'll see how many edible plant species we can find this morning. Let's do that while Jamie is in search of leopards. So, the magic guari. Now, a lot of safari guides will happily tell you the toothbrush story. I refuse to do so. But it is actually more an interesting species. Now, it always grows where there's a high underground water content. So very often on duplex soil, so you've got the sand and clay. And you can see the sand here, but there's clay just underneath. You can see there's a lot more grass than certain areas. The other nice thing about the guari is, if you've been bewitched, it's a very important tree. If you have had the black magic put on you, and one of the ways witches are quite fond of killing you out here is via lightning. But if you carry a guari branch with you, or you pop one in your house, in your home, it'll save you from the lightning. Now, the scientific name for the magic guari is Euclea divinorum. Sorry. Now, the reason it's called divinorum is it's used for water divining. So if you cut a nice forked branch and walk around, when you go over underground water, it'll pull you down. Now, I was a huge skeptic of water divining. Monkey. Where are we looking?
Dead.
Oh, all spotted. There you go. I'm pretty sure those vervet monkeys are in this area specifically for these guari bushes that are on fruit. There we go. That's actually quite a nice, interesting shot. You know, he's sitting in a dead knobthorn tree. And if we look behind over there, you can see the bush is moving. So I'm pretty sure there's more monkeys there. There we go. You can actually see one. There it is. Whoa! Jumping monkeys. So jumping straight into those guaris, and those guaris down there also fruiting. And the one in the dead tree is probably keeping a lookout for any potential predators. It's moved up to the left there. So having a look, making sure there's no... Oh, he's scratching himself. No, maybe... Oh, there we go. So it's more than likely a male, and he's keeping a lookout in case of leopard, lion, and birds. Actually, he's looking for martial eagles and things that might feed off monkeys. So you quite often with monkeys will find a sentry whose job is to make sure that everyone else is safe while they're feeding, and the sentry position will swap. So there we go. Now, often with a lot of the edible plants out here, we never get a chance because the monkeys are too fast, and the birds, and the civets, and everything. But fortunately, with quarries, they occur in such wonderful thickets, and you actually see the coloration of the ones that have fruit compared to the ones that don't. And you can see there's a slightly reddish tinge to them. So Annabelle is wondering, do they taste like blueberries? No. I would say they taste like a cross between blackberries and raspberries. Best description I can probably give. Unfortunately, as I said, there's not much flesh on them, and I would probably have to pick for the next 3 hours to actually get a big group of them. I know quite a few people make different preserves out of them, jams, marmalade, but it's a slightly more subtle taste, and if you get them slightly wrong, I mean, if they're a little bit unripe, the tannins in them are almost as bad as eating the leaf. Lady Luger was wondering, could they be made into jam or wine? I've never heard of them being made into an alcoholic beverage. In this part of the world, the two fruits that are generally chosen for the making of alcohol are the marulas, but we didn't have a very good marula season this year, and the brown ivory. The brown ivory, I wouldn't call it wine. It's probably more like moonshine. So very, very strong, and there's moonshine made out of it, and in South Africa quite a lot of our moonshine is called Mampur, and it is generally very strong. I tend to try avoid it. Vim, are you a Mampur drinker? No. And Vim says no. Yes. One tot of Mampur will put you on your head, so we generally try to stay away from that. As people who wake up early in the morning, generally disagrees. So Jamie and James and Tax and everyone are standing by trying to listen to where those leopards are. So when leopards are mating, they'll call about every 15 minutes. So the best way to find them is to just keep still and listen. And speaking of something that keeps still, and this animal is even named for keeping still. It is a little steenbok, or now it's on the move. And there we go. Little female steenbok. Basically translated to brick antelope, and their main defense against predators is to keep very, very still. Quite often they'll just lie down, go flat, and then just keep very, very still. And they live in such small territories, probably about 4 acres, so, and they defend that against other males and females, a completely monogamous pair. So when you live in a small area, you're always going to be around, so it's quite useful to be able to keep dead still. And I've watched leopard, lion, wild dog actually walk right past them. There we go. So it looks like our gremlin stick has worked. So no one's heard them again, so while they're all standing by very close in one area, we're just going to do this big long loop around the outside. So Megan's actually asked a very interesting question. Do monkey species ever alarm at humans? Vervet monkeys, not generally. In an area where they have been sort of persecuted by humans a lot, it is possible, but highly unlikely. It's got a caterpillar in its mouth. There you go. Is it a caterpillar? No, it's not. It is a... Is it? Where are my binoculars? I can't really see what it is that hornball's got. Maybe let's try it. Photograph. And try to figure out what he's got in his mouth. Oh dear, that didn't help much. It's a hairy caterpillar. And he's flown off. Now you can just see it. I thought it had wings, but it's not. So it's a hairy caterpillar, probably from one of the moths. And And we'll notice a lot of the birds are feeding off this explosion of caterpillars at the moment. And the cuckoos have even moved back in the area to feed off all those caterpillars. So while we continue on our meanderings, Jamie actually has a mammal with a heartbeat. Unfortunately, not the leopards, but I know she's still in hot pursuit.
I had a mammal. The mammal is slowly disappearing. And we've got some kudu here. Now, while you were with Brent, I've been sitting, listening intently. I found their tracks moving off into this block, and I heard something somewhere go, which is my sort of half-hearted attempt at what mating leopards sound like. And the difficulty is with an earpiece in and with the wind blowing, I couldn't determine exactly where it came from, and I caught only the tail end of it. I was in the middle of talking on Game Drive Channel, calling in the tracks when I heard it. So, you know, with your mind split in different directions and with your hearing split in different directions, I can't quite tell exactly where the sound was coming from. So I've been sitting, waiting for them to mate again so that we can figure out exactly where they are. The difficulty is...
Guys, that one of them says, one of us is on top of the sasa,
another
on the ground.
Gotcha. Copy that. Well done, Orbs. I'm going to make my way.
Yeah, Orbs, I met the Bella Nadia.
Awesome. So they were just that little bit further from where we thought they were.
Sorry, what? I keep coming south. Passing this all the busy car to track.
I'm also making my way up, but I'm still too far. I'm coming there slowly.
Yes, well done, Aubrey. Hey, Brian, some teamwork there. We got it. We got them. Told you we were going to get them. It was just a matter of time. Everybody watch your heads. Everybody duck. You okay there, Brian? Awesome. I'm so excited. I really, really enjoy seeing Tundi. Just that similarity, that genetic similarity between her and Shadow and Karula is fascinating to me. You can so clearly see that she's Shadow's twin sister. So I hope you're all as excited as I am. Ah, we nearly found them. Nearly. They were just that little bit further than I thought they were. It's amazing how the noise of mating leopards sound travels. And no wonder those kudu were looking so relaxed. Yay! Oh, what a way to continue a morning.
Yeah, I'll come with you.
Right, let's keep our eyes peeled, see if we can't spot Aubrey and Taxon. They're somewhere along this road. Wow, they're a lot further than I realized.
Over you, Aubrey.
That's incredible.
Is it okay if I bypass you and Zay's? I'm just going to shoot past, or is it on the antenna?
Liz in Wisconsin, you are very, very excited. It's the first time you've ever seen a Tundi.
Copy that.
It's only my third time, I think, seeing her, so I'm also incredibly excited. It's wonderful building up a collection of different characters. Wow, they're a lot further south than I realized. Goodness gracious. Well, at least we heard that. Brian?
Yeah.
we did well, sort of. Aubrey, can I make my way in?
Welcome to.
Copy that, thank you. Oh, so exciting. Now, where? Everybody seems to be looking in different directions. Oh, duh. She's just gonna walk straight across in front of us here. Hello, Tandy. How wonderful to see you. She's gonna go mate with him. Oh. They're both moving off. This is a very, very thick block. Thank goodness we've managed to see them now. Look at that size difference between a male and a female.
Yeah, different, yeah. So short.
Sure. Okay. This is where things are going to get a little bit tricky, everyone. I'm going to try to stay with them. Let's see if we can't find a path in. I'm going to try and move behind Taxon there. Hopefully they're not going to go too far. Just let Aubrey go ahead. Don't disappear into a thick block, not now that we've just seen you. Oh, at least we got to see them slightly. It's so dense in here. We all have to follow a very similar route to get in. This is going to be very, very tricky. It's an incredibly dense block, and there's three different vehicles moving about. So I'm just going to send you back across to Brent just while we make our way in here, and I'll catch up with you shortly with those leopards again.
So exciting! Amazing leopards. Vim,
sorry.
There we go.
Our antenna had fallen down, unfortunately. We did such a good job at beating gremlins, that even with the antenna down, it was working. So,
exciting stuff.
I know the male's Tingana. I'm not sure who the female is yet, but I'm sure Jamie will let you know as soon as she is able to.
Oh, it is Tandy.
Tandy Kele,
the loved one.
There we go. Isn't that exciting? So, while they follow up on that, I just chatted to Jams, and we're going to go see if we can find Karula. If no luck with Karula, I've had a report of the Inkahumas, unfortunately, quite far to the north of our traverse area, but that doesn't mean they couldn't come back. And they were hunting buffalo last night in Buffalo's Hook. They were hunting buffalo in Buffalo Corner. So we're going to check around towards the Mawati River and then head east and north, see if there's any tracks of any lions around. But the wonderful thing about being in the African bushes, even if there aren't any lions around, is lots of other wonderful things. I think we're going to continue on our mission to find as many edible plant species as possible today. And Liam and I are quite peckish, so we're going to keep snacking on the fruits of the bush as we move through. So Boyd is wondering, what is my favorite fruit in the area? Well, Boyd, if I can ever get to it, because quite often I'm beaten to it by the other primates and birds. Coming up to it shortly. And there's one of the more difficult ones. Let's go see if it's got any fruit on it. Here it is coming up here. It is the tree the Inkuma pride are named after. It's the brown ivory tree. Now, this is literally like a sweet in your mouth. Now, let's see, have we got any fruits? But as you can see, they're generally quite big trees, so it requires quite a bit of effort to get, but they haven't fruited this year, and it doesn't look like This one's going to, I can't see any fruits on that. Which is quite disappointing, I won't lie. Oh dear. No fruits on my favorite fruiting tree in the area. So we shall continue on. Something. So on these disturbed patches next to the edge of the roads, there's quite often some little perennial herbs that grow. And here we have one. Now, just because I said I was going to eat everything, I'm going to have to. And I don't really like it. There we go. This is for you, yeah? So I'm not a big fan of licorice, but this is wild aniseed.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. I don't really like licorice. And it's a really strong licorice flavor. Really, really strong. There we go. What did I do for you guys? So there we go. That's the little plant. And when I say strong licorice, I mean, you can smell it even when you drive over it. Sorry, am I moving too much, Vim?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let me put it on the dashboard then. And even when you dry over it, the smell of licorice permeates through the air. So, there you go. That's the second edible plant. Now, you can use it for cooking. And if you like licorice, then I'm sure it's wonderful. And I know a chef I used to work with often used to go out into the field and collect a lot of this. And he used to do sort of aniseed encrusted pork chops. Apparently, licorice and pork go well together. In my mind, licorice goes well with nothing. But there we go. Obviously, there it goes. So that's the second edible plant. One second, guys. Mike, as far as I know, there are three stations there, or two standing by. Just letting the other vehicles know while Jamie is trying to follow those leopards through the bush. You've got lots of hyena tracks around, but that is not uncommon. So, Vim, what do you think the next edible plant we shall find is?
No idea.
Just turn that down. Lots of chatter and traffic over those leopards. Oh! Well, it's edible, but it's certainly not a plant. And it's an old buffalo bull. I think he'd be a bit tough there. And I'm not going to go try to take a piece of tartar out of him. I think he will be just fine now. Got some oxpecks on his back. We've actually seen this bull a few times before. There's that wound on his right shoulder. And if he turns again, hopefully we'll be able to see it. Now, those oxpeckers provide a valuable service to a lot of animals, but they also quite often can cause some damage. So if we have a look at that wound, those oxpeckers have kept it open and made it bigger. So they feed off the congealed blood, so they keep picking at the wounds. There's red-billed oxpeckers with a juvenile. Now, this poor chap has definitely seen better days. He even has a large scar on his scrotum. That must have been quite painful. But he's definitely towards the end of his years. Even though there is quite a bit of grass, he's showing a bit of lack of condition. You can see how his hips are sticking out compared to the one behind him. So, and then you can see the large scar on his scrotum there. You can see he's broken his tail. His hips are sticking out, so he's definitely towards the end of his years. And you can see he's got quite a stiff walk, maybe a bit arthritic as well. So Steph says, loves to see these old buffalo bulls trucking along. And that's
literally what they're doing. They're just biding the time before the lions catch up with them. And one of the reasons that they're often together and not by themselves is just that a little group of them, they've got that little more chance of seeing off a lion attack. So, good old boys. Almost always reminds me of the of that song, American Pie, and the good old boys drinking whiskey and rye, except in this case, drinking pan water and feeding on panicum, what they do. So they're very much concentrated around areas of that are easy to feed in and have lots of water. But these guys are just getting moving now, so as it gets darker, especially as we go towards the winter months, the areas they like to feed in that have high numbers of decent grasses and easy access to water are generally quite low-lying, so they get quite cold at night. So you find them up, especially in the early morning and in the evening as it gets dark, you'll find them higher up on the crest of the hills. What they're doing there is that the warm air rises, so it is a couple of degrees warmer generally on top of the hill than it will be at the bottom. So they will now be moving down. I think those guys in particular are going to head towards the treehouse waterhole, where they will spend their day wallowing and feeding and doing pretty much as little as possible. So very interesting that. Now we haven't seen a big herd for a while, and that's probably because of the green flush that's around us, so they're quite well spread at the moment. So Jen B is one of our lucky viewers who's actually been out here, and she went to Arethusa. And she said, while they were at Arethusa, they had lucky beans. Now, what plant could this be from? Well, Jen, it could be from quite a few different plants. The Natal Mahogany has a nice big lucky bean, probably about 4 or 5 centimeters in size. We have a lucky bean creeper, which is very small and pretty, but all look the same. There's red and black beans. And then the coral trees. I think it's probably from a coral tree if it was very small. And I do remember seeing a coral tree in the Arethusa grounds. So maybe a coral tree, a mahogany, or a creeper are the three different species that have very distinct lucky beans that we get in the Sami Sands. There we go, very small. So they're either a lucky bean creeper or a coral tree. Now, a lucky bean creeper is not very common. So I'm probably going to go with a coral tree, and I do remember seeing a coral tree in the Arethusa Lodge grounds. Unfortunately, I would go look for one, but as far as I'm aware, we don't have any that I know of on Juma. But if we do head off that way, and if I remember correctly, the coral tree's in the middle of the lodge, we can't exactly drive back.
There you go. That, for those of you for whom this is a first-time experience, is what leopard mating sounds like. Now you can see why this block has been so difficult for us. It is almost impossible for us to get you a good view at the moment, unfortunately. But it was worth it just for the sound effects. And at some point, we will be able to reposition and get you a slightly better view, and they might move more out into the open. Oh, there was a sneeze there. So not the world's best view between the leaves, but at least you heard it. I'll try going forward a little bit, but I don't think that's going to help us very much. No. Okay. Well, we're going to settle here for the moment and just wait and see. Hopefully the two of them decide to get up and move more into the open. If not, we'll just wait for our turn to have a chance to have a look at them. Now, this, judging by the amount of noise coming from these two, these guys have just started their mating. And in fact, I believe that yesterday was the first day that they were seen mating together. There's a good chance I'm gonna have to reposition so that Aubrey can get out of here. It is an impossible block. You get the rough idea and see how dense this vegetation is. Believe it or not, there's two leopards hiding there. And if they didn't make such a noise, we may never have found them. Okay, should we do this? Should we try? Let's see if we can get a view. Oh. Gonna squeeze in here. Tundi there. Should I go back a little bit to you? There we go. At least we've got a view of Tundi, the beautiful Tundi, who looks so like her mother and her sister. At this point, I'm not even entirely sure where Tinkana is. I mean, I know he's there, somewhere next to her, but I cannot see him at all. It's incredible the way that leopard camouflage works. You don't think of the brown-tan color as being hidden in green, but when she lies like that, she could be part of the scenery, apart from that twitching tail. And slight signs of irritation. Now, leopard mating, and it applies to all big cats, leopard mating is a very angry affair. And the reason behind that is that the male's penis is barbed, which means it hurts the female. And they copulate sort of once every 5 to 10 minutes in the beginning of their mating sessions for about 4 to 5 days. There's lots and lots of energy expended. But that type of mating and that technique, that the reason that the male's penis is barbed is because the female needs that stimulation in order to ovulate. It's called induced ovulation. And what it means is that when she comes into estrus and she starts to mate, fertilization only occurs towards the end. And that means that a bigger, stronger, better male might have a chance to come along and mate with her, although Tundi would be hard-pressed to find a more suitable mating candidate. Tinkana's most definitely the largest leopard around Juma. He is second only to the Anderson male, who's a little bit further to the west of us. Poor Tinkana has definitely had a difficult few months. First approached by Shadow, Tundi's sister, then Karula, their mother, then Shadow again, then Karula again, then Kutile once, and then now Tundi. So he's definitely been working very hard at mating with the different females of the area. Isn't it amazing how a couple of weeks ago, a sighting like this, we would have been able to see her perfectly. There was hardly any grass in this area. If there was, it was basically ankle height. And now, we can barely see her behind the grass and the overgrowth. And Heidi, absolutely, might not have been the clearest view that we got, but you are right, just hearing the sounds that they make is incredible. It's such a strange sound, I mean, it's a combination of a growl and a roar and something else, a whine, I guess. Oh, exhausted now. It's clearly been a busy night for her. These two will continue this process for another few days before they go their separate ways. And chances are, unless the opportunity has really presented itself in a clear way, chances are they won't have eaten the entire time that they spend together. Which means that by the time they do go their separate ways, they're exhausted and absolutely starving. And as soon as she's finished with Tingana, she will go straight back south to her territory. She's right, she's sitting now. We are very close to our southwestern corner. She's actually sitting right in the overlap between her territory, her mother's territory, and her sister's territory. Which is fascinating. And she probably grew up in this area, or moving about this area. As far as I know, Tandy and Shadow are Karula's oldest cubs, or oldest offspring. They're definitely no longer cubs. That puts them on about 9 years old. Is that correct? Yes, 9 years old, going on close to, about 9 years old, unless I'm very much mistaken. Now I have one very sleepy cat. Since we're here, and at the moment we've got spots completely hidden in grass, we can have a look at the tree that is currently obscuring her on the right, or partially on the right. It is a round-leafed teak. It's one that's coppiced slightly, which is why it's growing in so many different directions. It's something that elephants love to feed on when it's young. They almost farm in this area. She thought about lifting her head there and then went completely back to sleep. And obviously the reason that I'm... Oh, heads up. She could, because it's cool this morning, she could well mate with him on an even more regular basis. So I've seen her on cool and cloudy mornings. I've seen them mate once every 2-3 minutes. So there's a good chance that she's going to get up at some point and harass him again, wherever he may be. Not entirely sure where that is. Just getting more comfortable in her blanket of grass. Look at that. It's fascinating. It's like looking at Shadow, but not, but different. Same shape of the nose as well. It's incredible that a close to 100 kilogram leopard, I think Tingana must be about 90 odd kilograms, which is close to 200 pounds. It's amazing how a 200 pound leopard can quite literally vanish from view in this vegetation. I don't know where, I have no idea where he is. I think he's lying up behind her, but I really honestly couldn't tell you. He must be. There's no other place for him to hide. But I mean, Tingana is not a small male. He's not a small animal. And the disappearing skills of leopards. Now imagine you're tracking a leopard on foot, walking through this kind of vegetation, and It's the Sabi Sands leopards, so most of them are exceptionally comfortable with people walking about them. Obviously, within reason, you keep your distance, they're still wild animals. But they, most of them, Karula, for example, will be comfortable and stay lying down with a person up to 20 meters or as close to as 20 meters. How close were you, Brian, that one day? Probably about 30 meters.
From Karula?
From Karula.
When we first saw one, maybe five.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, Brian's got a snake.
Look at this. The apex predator of the reptiles. It's a big black mamba, probably about 2 meters. Oh, look at it go. Definitely not the biggest we've seen, but spotted by Viam. See where it went, Viam?
Going into that bush there.
Into that bush. Well, we're going to take a slightly wild bird and get closer. Amazing how a snake that size can disappear.
Tail,
empty its tail. Here we go. Incredible. So it's got nowhere else to hide apart from that little bush. So go around a bit more so you can see its head. Now, as you can see, a black mamba is not black at all, but rather sort of a gunmetal grey. They get their name from the inside of their mouth being pitch black. Yeah, I think I see its body. There's some more of its body. Look at those scales. So it is hiding in one of the edible plants. I'm not going to go eat that plant though. I think it might be detrimental to my long-term plans. I wonder where the head is. Now, these are incredible predators. They hunt birds, lizards, chameleons, small mammals. Highly, highly neurotoxic venom. One of the most venomous snakes in the world. Yes, we did an interesting thing yesterday. We did a first aid training drill where I was bitten by, fortunately not a mamba, but a fictitious spitting cobra. And unfortunately, I did not survive the training exercise. Which obviously, you can see a bit of its body. You got it there, Viam?
Negative.
There we go, a little bit to the right. And just see there in the darkness. There we go. Try a slightly different spot. Now, one of the strangest things now, of course, we're not going to irate this large mamba too much. That's why we're keeping our distance. And I think it's going for the invisible vibes. And well, there we go, Matt in Nashville says he's been waiting to see a snake for weeks. There we go, Matt, that was a nice view of a black mamba. So obviously it's feeling slightly uncomfortable, that's why it's gone into that and it's hiding in that little thicket. But it's not really giving us another view. I'll try once more. I'm probably going to move away. Now, I think there's also a hole there. There seems to be a slight termite mound next to it. So maybe that snake has disappeared underground. No, I can still see the body there. So this is what often happens with snakes. There we go, you can just see the piece of the body there. So they are far more scared of us than we are of them. So instead of attacking us, the snake is trying to avoid us and hide from us. So we're gonna let it do that, but wasn't that amazing? That lovely sight of the apex reptilian predator. So we're gonna go in search of more apex predators. And I think we'll add it along with our edible plant search. We'll search for apex predators of all kinds. One of those, of course, is the lion. And we're gonna go check if we can find any tracks of the Nkahumas. And maybe we might be lucky enough to see a martial eagle, which is the apex predator of the air. Let's continue on. We're gonna head east. Are we on the eastern boundary? Sorry, heading north. Trying to see what else we can find. So Veer's wondering, is it more toxic? Sorry, Veer, I'm looking at tracks. Is it more toxic than that Australian common brown snake? I'm not sure, but I do know Australia has the most venomous snakes in the world. And I don't know if the common brown snake is the most venom, but if it is, I do know Australia has, I think, two or three species more venomous than a mamba. Oh, hello, kudus. Lovely little group of kudu. Those wonderful big ears. Oh, baby's off. Now, this little group of kudu had a couple of babies not too long ago, but unfortunately for them, they lost one of those babies to Gijima. Sorry, I think I've just moved forward slightly. We've got leopard tracks here on the road. We also have honey badger tracks. We've got multiple sets of tracks here. It's going to be quite confusing to work out what's what. Now, we want the leopard tracks on top of the honey badger tracks, not the other way around. Unfortunately, it looks like the honey badger tracks are on top and the leopard tracks are heading into Torchwood. It seems like it was a very busy road last night. It's honey badger marching backwards and forwards. Just stopping and listening. Yeah, Cape Turtle up. I think I heard some elephants screaming just down the road. I'm gonna go see if they're there. I'm gonna keep my eye on the tracks to see if I've made a mistake. There's definitely female leopard tracks here as well. So I'm gonna try to sort out what's going on with these footprints. While we do that, let's head back to Jeremy with Tingana and Tandi.
Wonderful news. We have the sighting all to ourselves for the moment, and therefore I don't have to whisper quite into the tucked up part of my shirt because there's, oh no, somebody else is on their way. Here we go, somebody's just joined us. So we've got the best visual that we can get at the moment. Believe it or not, I finally found Tingana. He is next to impossible to spot. Let me just see who's here. Isn't that incredible? There's a leopard there. And that's what I was talking about before Brent found that black mamba. We were discussing Brian's sighting with James on foot, and the fact that when they first saw Karula, she was 5 meters away, which is 15 feet, incredibly close. And she was perfectly comfortable with them. No, she just happened to stick her head up over the termite mound. Now, of course, immediately they moved away and to a slightly safer distance or slightly nicer distance, more comfortable for both them and for her. But it does happen that occasionally you stumble upon a leopard. But just imagine trying to track an animal through this area. And this is where the true master trackers are. so phenomenally skilled at what they do. Because they can see, they can track birds through the sky almost. Ooh, the tail twitched there. Is she thinking about getting up? I love how he's managed to tuck himself right underneath the log where it's going to be really difficult for her to get to him and harass him. Almost all of the initial mating is initiated by the female. And hopefully now with this view we can get to see the dance that she will do for him. But I mean, tracking through here, I could walk through this block within 20 meters, although I must say I'd be walking very, very slowly, given how thick it is. But I could be walking within 20 meters of them. I would, and there's two of them. I would have absolutely no idea they were here unless I heard them. This is where I think this is one of the attractions of leopards for people, is their sheer, what did I call it? Their subtlety, and it is, it's a true subtlety that is so attractive to us as humans. Their mysteriousness. We just got very lucky that we managed to find them on the road, or that Aubrey managed to find them on the road before they decided to disappear in here. We spoke about how Tundi is currently sort of in the corner of mainly Karula's territory, but with the overlap with Shadow and herself, in fact. And Shannon was wondering where exactly Tundi's territory falls. And although it's not an area that I'm familiar with, it seems as though it's to the south of us. So around Chitwa and Little Gowrie, and possibly even slightly into Hoffman's, although that's mainly Shadow's area, but maybe the sort of the northwestern corner of Hoffman's. And Shannon, I'm really sorry because I haven't managed to get the maps on my phone yet. The map, I think, would help us tremendously, although I'm sure if we ask nicely, Brent might be able to demonstrate. Oh no, he can't actually. He can't either because he doesn't have the maps with him. But I will, if we do have to leave the sighting, if other people do want to come and join us, then I will draw you a more complete picture. But suffice to say, it is in the southern, sort of the southern part, or just on the southern side of her mother's territory and to the east of her sister, across Gowrie, Maine. Any moment now, she should be getting up. I just want to see if this other vehicle might want to come and join us here, or if he's managed to get a good view from where he is. It's always a bit of a gamble with mating leopards because they could get up and move slightly into a completely different position before they mate. Hear the bleating warbler. Oh, head up. Oh, and two heads up. Now we must hope, with keep our fingers crossed and all of those things, that these two do not decide to go any further to the west. Oh, Tingana's back down again. So is Tundi. When they do go through here, the chances of us being able to follow them, even in our little vehicle. Taxon took one look at him, he said, if these leopards go any further west, we're going to lose them. Even Jamie won't be able to follow them. And that's just because it is monkey orange thicket that is so dense, I don't think we would manage it. But we've got to just enjoy as much time as possible with these leopards. Well, the two of them, as Subtle and mysterious as leopards are, you heard the noises that they were making, and that can and will alert almost everything in the area to their presence. And for the most part, that's absolutely fine. They're quick enough and agile enough to escape any unwanted attention. But Teresa was wondering, do leopards have any natural predators? Apart, of course, from... Oh, here she... Or not. Oh, even flatter. Completely stretched out and comfortable. And Teresa, yes, apart from man, of course, being the dominant apex predator in this area, although fortunately that man is not something that these leopards will ever, ever have to worry about. Within the Sabi Sands, they are completely protected. Their biggest threat out here would be the lions, and I have seen lions chase leopards before. They have been recorded to kill leopards as well, although that very seldom happens just because the leopards are so much more agile than the lions. But leopards, another threat in terms of predators would be potentially wild dogs. There are occasional cases of them being recorded to harass leopards that they've managed to trap on the ground. Although the leopards, again, the leopards' agility and tree climbing ability usually puts them far out of reach. And then occasionally hyenas, although most of the time hyenas and leopards have a relatively stable interaction. So a leopard will be chased off a kill by hyenas, but they won't go far. They'll sit and growl. For example, Tundi's sister Shadow and that sighting with Peter Pretorius where she killed an impala and was promptly chased off by two hyena, and she sat probably about 20 meters away, 60 feet away, just growling. Their biggest threat is during their first year of life. The cubs are the ones that face the highest mortality, and that's because they're not as alert, they're not nearly as agile as other animals, or as the adults are. Their biggest threat, 50% of cub mortality, is accounted for by interactions with other males. So unknown males coming in and killing the cubs in order to bring the female back into estrus and to pass on their own genetics. And the rest of the other 50% is made up of a combination of hyenas, lions. Very seldom will there be cases of leopard cubs being killed, for example. It'll be a very small percentage of leopard cubs being killed by eagles or snakes. And that's only when they've strayed from the den site or being located in the den site. It's a very unusual situation. Yesterday afternoon when we were alerted to the presence, just chatting a bit about Tundi's territory and the movements of them, when we were told about the sighting, James gave you that update that there were three leopards there and that we suspected that the third was Karula. James, you are absolutely right. There was a third leopard and it did turn out to be Karula. She did exactly what she did the last time this happened. The last time Tundi moved into her territory to mate with Tingana, Karula approached and sat a couple of meters away and growled and dribbled and was just very, very upset. And the same thing happened yesterday. And I think you can imagine how them being so close to her den site, even though they're not a threat, would definitely have put her nose out of joint. She cannot have been terribly impressed with them. So she did... They moved away from her rather than her moving away from them. She's probably still with the cubs around Little Gowrie. That's where her den site is. It's to the south of our traverse area. So she probably just stayed while they moved out. But you never know. She may have heard them coming further south again, and she might just make another appearance. That would be very interesting if Karula decided to come and join us. She does tend to do that. I think I'm choosing your route here, it's a bit thick, but yeah, let me start moving. There is another vehicle that is trying to make their way in. And I might have to, in order to give him a view, I might have to reposition slightly. We'll wait for now until he gets in here. And we'll just give the leopards a chance to decide if they're going to stay here or if they're going to move. Nemo is wondering about the pretty little blue flower in front of our very sleepy leopards. And Nemo, from here it looks like it is a commelina. A commelina flower, named after the commelina brothers, who were all botanists. And that's this, there were three of them, just like there are three petals of the commelina flower. That's what it looks like from where I am sitting. Quite difficult to judge, and as much as I appreciate the presence of Tundi, I don't think I'm going to be heading over there to pluck it anytime soon. But what I'll do for you is I will have a lookout, and we'll ask Brent to have a lookout for one of them as well, so that we can give you a slightly closer view. Isn't it incredible how the flowers have shot up recently, just since the rain? I really thought it was too late, but the ground is covered on quarantine and strings of stars and devil thorn flowers. The change in the environment is phenomenal. Poor Mike is trying to make his way into the sighting. It's not an easy thing to do, and it's made a lot more difficult when the vehicle is about twice the length of ours. Oh, hold on. Which way is he going? Oh no, that's okay. Now, I've tracked a couple of leopards before that have been sleeping just like Tundi, and the two of us have surprised each other in the most interesting way. You can just imagine the reaction when you're walking along and all of a sudden there's a leopard exploding or out of the ground in front of you. Or off the ground in front of you, although it does feel as though they've popped up out of the ground and launching itself away from you. It doesn't often happen. I mean, we walk around with our senses very much on high alert. Oh, I think she's going to get up now. Sorry, I just need to give Mike some instructions here. Mic for Jamie. Mike, have you seen where these ingwe are?
Jamie, I haven't got visual yet, but I'm right at the scene.
Okay, copy. They're just about 10 meters away from you on my left in this thicket. I don't think you're going to get a visual going in the direction you're going in. I think come around the marula tree that's on your right. Come around and come behind me.
Okay, all right, copy.
Just making sure poor Mike doesn't make his life even more difficult in this thick block. Oh, so much for Tundi deciding to move. Speaking about how difficult it is for us to find leopards, it is much, much easier if you're a leopard yourself. And Charlotte, who's watching in Port Elizabeth, Charlotte would like to know, how do these leopards find each other when it comes time to mate? Does the female follow the scent marking of the male? Charlotte, there's a combination of different factors. A lot of the time, the female will find the male through scent marking. A lot of the time, the male will actually find the female through her scent marking as well. Obviously, it's up to her to let him know that she's an oestrus, and that comes through very clearly in the urine spraying that they both do. So she will urine scent mark, he will be on his regular patrols. She will be a lot more active in terms of her scent marking when she is in estrus. So she'll move about her sort of the fringes of her territory or her home range. And as soon as a male comes through that is possibly or that will be interested, he'll have a good sniff and then start looking for her. The other way that they find each other is through calling. Now I'm just going to have to reposition ever so slightly, see if I can't help Mike out here and make it a bit clearer. I'll move forward for you now. Can you see them there? Okay, we're just going to share the sighting with the rest of the guests. They haven't had a chance to see it. So I'm going to try and shuffle forward so that we will only have a view of Tundi for now. Sorry, Brian. I'm going to put you at a bit of an angle. Let Mike move forward a bit behind us. Hopefully we'll be in a prime spot to see Tingana when he does get up to mate. I'm sure they're going to get up soon anyway to mate. Fingers crossed. Now that I've said that, they're going to spend the rest of the morning fast asleep. Oh, I think, unfortunately, where we are now, Brian can't really see Tingana. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and shuffle about, see if I can't find us a better view. While I do that, let's find out what Brent is up to for the morning.
So, Liam and I are checking at the northern perimeter, seeing if there's any tracks of the Nkuhumas possibly coming back. And I heard the pretty leopard were in front of a pretty flower. And I went and found said pretty flower so you guys could have a closer look. And it is a blue commelina. There we go. Hey, pretty flower. Got two very big petals and one very small petal. I always think a lot of these flowers look like elephants. So if you put it there, you need to use your imagination slightly. Then you see there's ears and the eyes. This one's got a third eye, but in the trunk and the two tusks. Oh, sorry, my cap's in the way. Here we go. Blue commelina, named after three botanists that were brothers, and two made major discoveries, and that's represented by the two big petals, and the third, he died before he could do anything of influence, and represented by the small one. Megan's wondering if there are any herbs or spices in the bush that can be used for cooking. Well, Megan, that licorice or aniseed that VM and I were eating earlier can be used for cooking. Also, there's wild basil, onycum, that can also be used for cooking. But since we are going to do some flowers, this is a good spot. We have some multiple species. So there's species number one. And species number two, number three. I saw another one here somewhere. Well, we'll just do three for now and we'll keep going. Unfortunately, well, some of these are edible, but you need to cook them first. And look at me, I'm a decorator. And here, species number four. So we got yellow, white, pinky and blue. Let me just put my ears back in. So, this I think James showed you yesterday on the Sunrise Fire. It's called wing-seeded sesame. Now you can extract oil that can be used for cooking and whatnot from this one. Oh, very interesting, Vim, very interesting. Oh, no, it's not. So I thought I saw a mite inside, but it wasn't. So wing-seeded sesame. And let's do that one last. And this is the one, we all know this one, we see it quite often, we've shown it to you many times. It is called a string of stars or a lamb's tail. Probably the most common of the wildflowers we see. And it is a heliotrope. So during the day when the sun is shining, the flowers will move ever so slowly, slower than the human eye can see, following the sun through the sky. Now, this one you should definitely not eat. This one doesn't even have an English common name. It's only got a scientific name, and it's called Waltharia indica. And this is the host plant species for my favorite type of butterfly, the acrias, and the larval stage sequest a poison from it, hydrogen cyanide. So when they become adults, they're very noxious, and that's why they are very beautiful, beautifully colored, to warn all the birds not to eat them, because they taste fluffy. Now, another onto the last, but certainly not the least. It is definitely the least in what can be used and interesting things about it. Not much about it apart from that this grows on sandy, disturbed sandy soils. I just think it is one of the prettiest flowers we find. It is so delicate and so tiny. It's called a blue haze. I also just like the name, I think. Its scientific name is an evolvus. So it's evolving, I'm not sure how. But I just think it's incredibly beautiful and incredibly delicate, the blue haze. Okay, let's meander on. While we meander on, let's go back to Gemma and the leopards.
Okay, so there's another vehicle that would very much like to come and join the sighting. And since the other two vehicles haven't had a chance to see the mate, it's time for me to pull out and let them come in. Just thought we'd say a brief goodbye to them. And if we have a chance towards the end of the sunrise safari, we will come back to these leopards. I just wanted to let you know I do have to leave now, but that we will come back if we can. It's just fair to let the other vehicles have a chance. So while I make my way out of this block, why don't you head back onto the back of Brent's vehicle?
Alas, you had to leave those wonderful kitty cats, but hopefully we'll be able to catch up with them either later in the drive or on the sunset safari with James and myself. But for now, we are checking the northern perimeter, seeing if we can find any signs of the Nkuma pride. Oh, yellow, 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 bright and beautiful. Now this, oh, it's absolutely stunning. This is a senna, and the smell, I'm actually taking this home, I'm gonna put it in my bedroom. Oh, it is gorgeous, smell that, Liam. So, better than the best perfume. I'm trying to describe this. It does almost smell like roses, believe it or not. Wow, that is beautiful. So, very pretty flowers, and one of the things I love about flowers, and I am a very, very big flower fan, it has got me mocked on many occasion, but how each different species of flower has got a different design, specially suited to different types of insects. Now, if we go back to my favorite little pretty blue one, now you can see the size difference between them, and the same insect that pollinates this is definitely not going to pollinate that. So the sort of different little segments of the flower is they're all designed to suit a different species of insect. Now these guys, you can see they're big and open, quite often get fed on by quite a few different fruit chafer beetles. So the fruit chafer beetle, it's designed to be big enough that the beetle can crawl through there, get covered in pollen, fly off to the next one. Also you find quite a lot of the big wasp species, and of course honeybees. Now, and then this little one, there's actually a couple of tiny species of wasp that feed off this, but mostly it's flies that pollinate the little blue evolvus. So I do love flowers. I think I'm actually going to another one to put in my room to get. There we go. Ah. Almost want to tie it around the base of my neck so I can. So smart. VM says this looks nice. I don't know what you guys think, but yes. I want some tape. Okay. VM is now forcing me to do this now. Let me just strip the button leaves. It could be my corsage. And a very important thing, if you're on any form of film set, there are two of the most important things you need out here. VM is going to fetch the other one now. One of them is good tape, and VM will never be found anywhere in the world without a packet of these, of various different sizes, cable ties. So you can pretty much fix anything with some good old duct tape or gaffer tape and a cable tie. Okay, here we go. There we go. Pop that there. How's it look, Finn?
Are you going to a wedding?
It looks like I'm going to a wedding. There's no weddings today, but it smells so nice. Nemo, on the subject of flowers, I was wondering, are there any edible wild flowers like buttercups? There are a few edible flower species, but quite often they need to be prepared, so you can't just eat them raw. Well, you probably could. They wouldn't do anything bad to you, but they probably just wouldn't taste too pleasant until they've been prepared. So another one of the edible flower species that we saw a couple of days ago is the wild foxglove. Now, raw, it has the most disgusting smell. It smells very similar to cat urine, but once it's cooked, it becomes really, really sweet and tasty. So I'm trying to think of offhand any flowers that you can just eat. I'm afraid I might be incorrect. I'm sure there is one, but my brain is not functioning to find it. But I will keep thinking about that, Nemo. But you can eat a lot of the flowers, but generally they need to be prepared first. Oh dear, can't have that now. Sorry, I didn't stick it properly. There we go. Now, a long time ago, when I used to work in a very busy, fancy safari lodge, I had a guest who would literally throw up at the smell of a carcass. Quite difficult when you're trying to show people lions and leopards, because quite often they're around very smelly carcasses. And this exact species of plant, the senna, I literally broke off a branch for her, and we went into a very, very rotten hippo carcass that was being fed on by the coalition of male lions at the time, which was the Mapocho males. And she literally spent the next 45 minutes like this, while looking at the lions, breathing in the beautiful smell of the senna, rather than the rotting maggoty corpse of the hippopotamus. So we are getting into the zone now where if the Ngumas have come back from the north, they're going to cross. It's going to be in the next sort of kilometre and a half, so we're going to slow down slightly and start staring at the ground again. But while I'm staring at the ground, don't worry, I still am looking forward to having your questions. And if is anyone new there, is not sure how to get your question answered, pop us an email on questions@wilder.tv, or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So on the subject of lions and some color variations, Emily is wondering, would like to know more about white lions and are there any in the area. Unfortunately, there are not. There are some not too far away from us, though. Some to the east of us and some to the north of us, northwest. So, white lions, it's a double recessive genetic that causes that. The correct terminology for them is leucism. They're leucistic lions, and that means they're not albinos. Albinos is a complete lack of pigment in the skin and the hair. Leucism is just a lack of pigment in the hair only. So it's generally more common in birds. You find a lot more leucistic birds than animals. So white lions are leucistic lions. And the area that white lions are most famous from is just to the northwest of us. It's called, oh dear, there might need more tape. It's called the Timbervati Private Game Reserve. And it is an area where the Birmingham boys come from. So it is possible that those Birmingham boys carry that white lion gene. But for a double recessive gene to come through, thank you, Vin, you actually need to have both male and female carrying that gene. So it's no point one or the other carrying. And so it has to be the male and the female both carry that gene, and that's when it comes through. Now, there have just been some new white lions that were born in the Kruger National Park to the east of us. So there's three of them there at the moment. I think there's another three or four in the Timbervati. So, unfortunately, with captive lion industry and breeding industry and cub petting and all those horrible things, white lions are quite a sought-after creature. So a lot of people have put a lot of white lions or done genetic tests, and any lion that carries that recessive gene, they'll try and mate with another lion that has that recessive gene. So a lot of the white lions you see in zoos and places around the world, very, very inbred. So it is a bit of a problem. Everyone seems to like an anomaly. So it has caused excessive breeding. So you find there's very little genetic variation in a lot of wild lions in captivity. Fortunately, the ones in the wild, in the Timbervati, they're very healthy genetically. But who knows? Maybe one of the Nkuruma ladies is carrying the recessive gene, and the Birmingham boys as well. Now, don't get too excited. I'm playing speculation here. It's highly unlikely that the Nkurumas or the Sticks are carrying that recessive gene. Not impossible. Probably a chance of about one in a million. So there's always the possibility we could have a white lion born in the Sabi Sands. However, in the last 30 or 40 years, there hasn't been one. So that probably means that the females in this area are not carrying that gene. But you never know. One of my favorite topics during the summer months, and Megan would like to know, is there a national or official flower of South Africa? There is. It's a very beautiful flower as well, and it is called the Protea. Now, unfortunately, I do not have it in a book with me, so I suggest you go online and search Protea. There are quite a few different species in South Africa, but the national flower of South Africa is the King Protea. Very, very beautiful, very big flower. And King Proteas are endemic to fynbos, if I remember correctly. Fynbos is a very specific biome that occurs around the Western Cape. Now, we do have other proteas that occur outside of the fynbos, but they are a mountainous species, so they're high up on the mountains. So have a look online, Google Protea, Protea. Or more specific, King Protea. That's the national flower of South Africa. Speaking of national things, of course, the national animal of South Africa is the Springbok. That is also the name of our rugby team. The national bird of South Africa. Vim, do you know what the national bird of South Africa is? Crane. Yes, well done, Vim. It is the blue crane. Do we have a national tree? I'm not sure. I don't think we do. Maybe if you guys check, I think we do. I'm not sure what it is. So do me a favor, jump on that Google search engine or whatever you prefer and type in National Tree of South Africa and let me know. You guys can teach me something today. What is the National Tree of South Africa? So if you find out that information, pop me an email, questions@wildearth.tv, or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. So, those lions were chasing buffalo probably about 2-3 kilometers from this very point. We're going to start checking very carefully for tracks, and fingers crossed that they have decided to bless us with their presence. But I do have a sneaky sinking sensation that they are still to the north. Don't fly. It's not something we see them quite often, but they generally fly away at speed. There we go. A red-faced mouse bird. Oh, there it goes. Darling, so it was a quick view. It is one that I think some of you might be able to add to your bird list, because we haven't managed to catch them on camera too often. They are seem to be quite skittish flying around. And nice to get a view of a bird we don't see often, specifically on a morning like this, which is not a great birding morning. I did know that. Thanks to Jason and Tim. I did know that. I just couldn't remember. The national tree of South Africa is a yellowwood, and they're very beautiful trees. They generally live in the Misbelt region, so somewhere between the high veld and the low veld, and in forests. They are very, very slow-growing trees and actually quite endangered. So the first colonial settlers used yellowwood for everything. The wood is fantastic. It is now illegal to cut them down, of course. My parents have a massive yellowwood table. Now, that was made probably about 200 or so, 180 years ago. The wood was cut, and it was used as the beams in a big old farmhouse. And as that farmhouse got dilapidated, my dad managed to find that wood, and he got a carpenter to turn it into this beautiful dining room table. But it is a stunning wood, and any yellow wood furniture products are very, very valuable, because of course you can't make any more, and it is illegal to chop any of them. And there we go. Thanks for that, Jason and Tim. You learn something new every day. And thanks for helping me out there, guys. And while we continue the hyena track, check for lion tracks, let's go see what Jamie's been up to.
The only place where I've actually seen a yellowwood tree in this particular area, and I think the only area that it actually occurs in within the low veld, is on a mountain known as Maripskorp. Now, Maripskorp is part of the Drakensberg mountain range. It's the tallest mountain in this particular area, and it has the most incredible vegetation you will ever see. You drive up towards it, because you can drive, you can also climb it if you really want to, but you can drive up along bush, just like the bush we're looking at now, typical low veld woodland, bush veld woodland or savanna. And you drive up a little bit, and all of a sudden you hit this line where the mist, it's basically the mist line and the cloud line, and it turns into forest. The most incredible, it's almost like a rainforest, it's so moist. It's the most fascinating experience because the transition is completely sudden. And then if you continue on upwards, and you go up just that little bit further, you get to vegetation that is basically described as fynbos. Our fynbos, of course, you spoke about the national flower, the protea. Fynbos is a distinct floral kingdom, and it's the only, South Africa's the only place in the world where the entire floral kingdom is contained within one small area, and that's around the Cape area. But if you go up to the top of Maripskorp, you'll actually find all of these rhinostobos type bushes and parts of the daisy family that is definitive of fynbos. It's absolutely incredible to witness. Hello, buffaloes. I've come across to Treehouse Dam just while I wait for our chance to go back into that sighting, once the other vehicles have pulled out. Just in thought, the vague thought that perhaps Karula might have decided to follow along the tracks of the mating pair. Her den site is sort of about 2 kilometers south, directly south of Treehouse Dam. So she could well have come through this area. At the moment, though, the only occupants of Treehouse Dam appear to be these Dugger boys. the male buffalo that we've pretty much seen every single time we've come to Treehouse Dam in the last few days. A lot of them lying down, and you'll find that, again, that is the typical behavior exhibited by animals in this windy weather. They prefer to lie down and let the wind glance over them. But yes, Mareepscorp, if you ever find yourself in South Africa and in the Hoedspruit area or the Kruger area, I would highly, highly recommend paying a visit to Mareepscorp. It is breathtakingly beautiful, and apparently on a clear day, you can see all the way across to the sea, which is that's very far away from where we are at the moment. Now, Brian and I were just discussing I know you were discussing national birds and stuff. We were trying to think of our national, if we have a national arthropod or an insect. I've suggested that the South African national arthropod should maybe be a millipede, but I have absolutely no idea if we have one or not. Do we? I have no idea. But I feel as though a shongololo or a millipede, maybe that's, I'm biased because they're my favorite arthropod. Standing by. Copy that, thank you. There's nobody else who wants to make their way to that Ingwe sighting?
So far, did you hear someone?
Copy that, perfect, thanks. I'm at Treehouse Dam, I'll be there in a couple of minutes.
Copy.
Awesome, okay.
Jamie, how far are they from Triple M at the moment?
Brent, they're far still. I'm not showing any signs of getting mobile yet.
Copy, thanks.
Okay, let's do a quick loop and make our way back towards our lovely leopards. Hopefully we can have a chance to see them mating properly, not through all the bushes and vegetation, and see them mate as opposed to just listen to them. I know we have a national fish. I know we do. And I cannot think what it is. I feel like it's a yellow something, although that maybe I'm just confusing it with the yellow wood. But I'm sure you'll all agree, millipede is definitely a good choice for a national, not insect, it's not an insect by the truest definition, it's an arthropod. As though the national fish should be a coelacanth. It's not. The coelacanth, of course, being a fish that was thought to be long, long since extinct until they found one off the coast of Cape Town. But I believe that it's not, and the national fish is called a... What is that again? A falyun. Or a black bean fish, apparently, is what Kirsty tells me in Final Control. It's a tricky name. I still feel like it should be a coelacanth. Now, the funny story about the national bird in Botswana, apparently, is something that I was always told. So the national bird of Botswana is a western cattle egret, officially. However, most of the depictions of their national bird do not look like the somewhat, in their opinion, boring western cattle egret, and they've in fact decided that perhaps the lilac-breasted roller would be a better choice. And I could sort of see where that comes from, the bright-colored purples and blues. Well, I quite like western cattle egrets in their own way. A bird that we occasionally see here, but not all that frequently. Just want to double check these tracks that are walking along the road. I think it's just hyena. No. Hold on. Leopard tracks. This must have been where they crossed in. The light is terrible, otherwise I would show you what I'm looking at. Just want to double check again, because it could be Karula. It could be Karula coming in on, hot on their heels in response to the presence of her daughter in her territory. Oh, they've disappeared off the road. I'm trying to see if there were male tracks there as well, or if it was just females. The feet looked a little bit big for Karula. Karula's feet, Karula's tracks are quite tiny. But that was specifically why I came across to this area. Brent for Jamie. Brian, on your side, can you see if it's just female? Or can you see if there's a bigger track with it?
The one.
Interesting. Very interesting. Copy that. Thanks, Mike. I'm making my way back towards that sighting, unless anyone wants to go ahead of me. There we go. I think we've got two sets of tracks there. Let me pull over so that you can see more clearly what I'm looking at.
Jamie, it seems like you're good to come through then. There's also another route on the other side of the Ingwers, on the opposite end of where you were, where you can actually see them from the front. There's a little bit of a gap, so I don't know if that's maybe better as well.
Copy that, thanks, Mike. I'll see when I get there. Just bear with me one second. We are going back towards these leopards, but
Jamie,
I just...
Jamie, on the western town.
Brent, I was just wondering if we knew exactly where these Ingwer crossed. I've just found some tracks form a fuzzy on the road coming up from towards Treehouse from the Gowri Main Shabam Junction.
Copy. All three had tracks of two of us. I think Karula was
playing. I think Karula's followed behind.
With amazing pairs. Tracks of Gormit have gone 2 meters located in the left.
Okay. Copy that. Sorry, guys. Just chatting to Brent. We're just getting an update. He's been tracking the Nkuhumas, but unfortunately, they've just been found on Simbambidi, so outside of our traverse area. And I just want to check this very carefully because I want to see, no, this is Tingana. These are too big for ladies. No. Definitely male there as well. Okay. So it was, this is where Tundi and Tingana crossed in. That doesn't mean that Karula's tracks are not here though. She could well be following behind just to make sure, or just to monitor exactly where Tundi is in relation to her territory. I'm going to make my way back towards that leopard sighting. While I do, let's find out how Brent's tracking experiences have been going.
So, unfortunately, we've just found the tracks of the Nkuhumas, and I just spoke to the guys in Simbambili, and they have found them. So, they were chasing a herd of buffalo across the road behind us. It doesn't look like they were successful. So, the ladies are still hungry, and that means hopefully they'll come back towards us. On the sunset safari, but they have seemed to be avoiding us at the moment, just diving through the corner. Just 1 second. Go ahead. Copy, thanks. So it looks like Karula was trailing the mating pair last night, as she often does when a random female comes into her territory. Although this female random, it is her daughter from her first litter, Shadow's sister. vibrations. Let's try. Avoid it. Anna Marie is wondering why this gorilla follow the mating pair. She doesn't understand. Well, what happens is that female leopards will move well out of their home range or territory to mate. And there's sort of almost, it's like an unwritten rule between female leopards. They won't really attack that female while she's mating, but they will keep an eye on her to make sure that she leaves the territory. So that's quite often, and we've seen Karula follow Kwatile and Vula when they were mating. We've seen her follow Tandi and Tingana when they were mating, so it is quite normal. Now, update on Kwatile, she has not been seen again, so the all likelihood she has moved on to the next plane from that snake bite. Yesterday I was very fortunate, I was visiting friends of mine, and I got to see Takani, which is Kwatile's daughter, who's about 3 years old at the moment, and she seems to have inhabited that most of what was Kwatile's territory. Very beautiful little leopard. It looks very similar to her mother, and her mother was a particularly pretty leopard. So that is how it works out here. So it did not take long for that void that was left by Kwatile to be filled. Let's show you. I have a treat. I will post some pictures of this, but I do have a few pictures of that beautiful little leopard, and she is in. Let's find a good one for you guys. There we go, the one on top of the termite mound. I think that's a nice one. There we go. You can see how young she is. No marks on her ears yet. Very little scarring or scratches on her face. So there we go. That is Takani, who has taken over her mother's territory. Now, I was chatting to the guys who see her quite regularly, and she has been spotted with the Anderson male, but she hasn't been seen mating yet. She might be a little bit on the young side for mating. If she is going to mate, it's going to be probably in the next couple of months. So very, very exciting. Even though we don't get to see her often, just to know that Kwatile's lineage carries on. Now, I know that whole family of leopards from when I worked to the south, and we used to see quite a few of them. So she is of a river leopard lineage, so her genetics come all the way from the Sand River. Very, very interesting. And with all the Panthera studies at the moment, to be able, once that stuff is released, to be able to interconnect and figure out how the different lineages moved, where they've moved to. So she is still what we would classify as a river leopard. So just on the Manyaleti River. So she's taken over that Kwatile zone, and it is a very beautiful zone on the big Sand River. Now imagine the Mawati and times it by 10. So this big Sand River. We're going to try and get off the corrugations and go see what else we can find inside Juma. Chatting about leopards and leopard cubs, and of course the very exciting fact that Shadow and Karula both have cubs at the moment. Amanda is wondering, how long will a leopard cub stay with its mother? Now, Amanda, it depends whether it's a male or female. The males will stay quite a lot longer than the females. Females generally will become independent just over a year. And what the mother does to give that cub the best opportunity at getting a nice successful start in life, she will generally almost give away a portion of her territory to her cub. Sorry. Just listen to the radio quickly. Just finding out about Birmingham male lions, where they are, what they're up to, but nowhere we can go, and it doesn't look like they're heading towards us anytime soon. So, carrying on with the leopard cub discussion, as I was saying, a female leopard will almost give away a portion of the core of her home range to a mother leopard will give to a female cub. Now, this enables this female cub to have a very easy start in life. She doesn't immediately have to go out and start fighting for a territory with an older and established leopard. So the female will actually go do that. And if you watch female home rangers, the older they get, the smaller they become, as she gives off various parts to her offspring. Now, male leopards will spend a lot more time with mum. They will stay with mum normally to just around 2 years, even as long as 3 years, but normally around 2 to 2.5 years, they'll stay with mum. Now, the reason a female leopard seems to put more effort into raising a boy is that is the best chance for her genetic code to be passed on to a lot of different females. So, of course, those males at about 2.5, 3 years old will become nomadic, and they will wander often very far from their natal home range. And by the time they're sort of 5, 6 and start challenging for a territory, they are very far from the mom's spot. So, and over a male leopard's life, he's going to mate with multiple females. So the reason that the female spends a little bit longer with those males is that it's the best chance for her genetics to be passed on to multiple different females. Also, that male has to immediately, as he becomes dispersal, he's got a much tougher life than that female who's got this lovely insular little territory within sight, often within her mother's. So it is very interesting that, and it's amazing how evolution has created these different tactics for the same animal and even the same litter. Chatting about, and I just showed you a picture of Tikani, and Maurice is saying she's left her home range and hopefully we'll see her on Juma. I think it's unlikely. I think she's very much in the core of what was her mother's territory where we saw her yesterday. So I think it's not impossible, but it's unlikely that we see her on Juma. If we do see her on Juma, it is probably going to be a very similar situation to what we experienced now with Tingana and Tandi, is that she's going to be following a male to mate, and I think that's our best chance at seeing her on the live drives. So we're gonna go have a sniff around Treehouse, that area. So there were tracks of two females, so and Tingana. So I think Krula might have been trailing them last night. We don't have any tracks crossing back south, so there's a strong possibility she is in that area, and that is one of her most favoured hunting areas. So we're going to do a little meander past the Treehouse waterhole, just have a look around. I might have to take off my flower in case I need to smell for rotting carrion so we can find a carcass. And if we get no luck there, then we'll amble down towards the Mwati riverbed, see if we can possibly pick up any tracks in that area. Chatting about birds, and I know you guys heard a very strange noise on the Juma cam a few nights ago. It sounded like something getting murdered, and I'm 100% sure now, after listening to it again and having a look, it is a grey heron. And Monkey Man's wondering, do we ever get Goliath herons? Now, Goliath heron is, of course, the biggest heron species. Imagine that with a name like Goliath. And Monkey Man's wondering, do we ever get them on Juma? We do, but they generally are more pescivorial than the other herons. So they do eat frogs and etc., but they have a very strong affinity for fish. And after that very dry patch we went through this wet season, the fact that most of the fish have died or are hiding under the mud has meant we haven't seen too many last wet season we saw. And I think the best chance at seeing them would be having a look on the Arethusa dam cam. Arethusa will probably pull the odd Goliath heron. That's not to say it's impossible for them to arrive at Juma, and they do move between different bodies of water. but I think for this year they're going to be more concentrated around the more permanent pieces of water, so around the Sand River, the Sabi River, and the bigger man-made water holes like the one in Arethusa. There's one in Chitwa and in Buffleshog. Actually, I did see one the last time I was fortunate enough to go up north to Buffleshog. So I'm sure a few of you are wondering what a Goliath heron looks like. It is a very pretty bird, and it is a very big bird. So, it is the largest heron in the world as well. So they're very pretty, very regal looking. Now, they are about 1.4 meters tall. So very, very tall. It is a very beautiful bird, very distinguishable because of its large size. So of the heron species, he'll eat much bigger fish than the others, and hopefully we will get one before the dry season sets in fully, and I think maybe Buffleshog Dam might be our spot to spot the Goliath heron. And while we continue on, we're gonna head towards Treehouse, see if we can find Karuna. And while we do that, Jamie is back with Tingana and the loved one Tundi.
We have arrived back at our mating leopard pair. They are currently occupied in their favorite occupation, or with their favorite occupation, of sleeping. At least we've got a really nice view of Tingana now. And now we're sitting all by ourselves with these two leopards. Tundi, although you can't really see her, is right hidden at the back. There you go, you can just see the spots of the back of her neck. That's Tundi at the back there. Apparently they did mate while we were checking our Treehouse Dam, but hopefully we'll get one last chance to see it before the end of the sunrise safari. And fingers crossed they'll still be here this afternoon as well for the sunset safari. It's just going to be a matter or a question of finding them. He's found such a comfortable looking leopard spot. I can't even at this point tell what tree that used to be, but this fallen one, you can see all of the charred marks around its base. So that's probably what killed it. Either lightning or fire moving through this area. And I know that this area did burn a couple of years ago. And it's provided him with a perfect, slight shady cover, because even though it is cloudy, the temperature is still heating up this morning. And he's got a soft patch of grass, nice shade, and it's quite a lot of work for the female to come and harass him. I think he's found the perfect position. Beautifully framed by that dead tree. And there's not much more in the world, there's no other animal that can look as comfortable as a leopard can, except perhaps a lion. But a leopard can make any position, even if it's on top of a very uncomfortable looking termite mound. They make it look somehow like the most comfortable place on earth. I'm just listening really carefully. I can hear elephants trumpeting off in the distance. And there's a chance, a small chance, but a chance nonetheless, that they will come and pay us a visit. And that's always interesting, watching elephants interact with predators, even leopards. Now, if they spot them, they will try. There's a very good chance that they will try and chase them away. I've seen it happen once or twice before. And in that respect, elephants are fascinating because there's some kind of residual instinct there that tells them that they must chase a predator, even a leopard that is of absolutely no threat to them whatsoever. and wild dogs even less so, yet wild dogs seem to offend them the most. Oh! Lots of trumpeting. Very upset elephants. I'm just gonna listen for a second. They're far away. But it did make, it always makes me wonder, having chatted a bit about their reaction to other predators, if they haven't possibly encountered something that's upset them. The fact that they're still trumpeting. Usually when elephants are upset with each other, the squeals or the trumpets last for a little while, but they stop relatively quickly. It might also be the wind. I spoke about the fact that it is a windy day. It might also be the wind that's unsettling them. I'll keep listening. You never know. Wild dogs are so unpredictable, they might have just decided to run onto the property without any of us being aware of it. Tingana, however, not in any way interested in the sound effects of the morning. Now, Bea, you have suggested that the tail looks as though it has a life of its own. I find leopard tails absolutely fascinating. The degree or the lack of control that a lot of the cats, but particularly leopards, seem to demonstrate over that tricky thing that is the tail is so interesting and intricate to watch. Of course, that tail plays such an important role in communicating their mood to other leopards and to other animals, as well as a rudder for when they are running, a sort of a counterbalance. But look at it twitch. I mean, yes, we see their ears twitch a lot, but that's almost always in response to flies or to noises. This tail doesn't have any flies around it. It just twitches. And I've noticed, I don't know what it is, but particularly Karula to me, and I did ask the other day whether any of the viewers agree with me that Karula seems to have a more active tail than, for example, Tingana does. I've just noticed that even when she's asleep, there's that constant flick and twitch. And the interesting thing is that that tail, or that lack of control over the tail, can sometimes give them away when they're moving through an area. Because it's a very clear white tip to the end, that color shows up very clearly to the animals in the bush. And I've seen a leopard stalk for hours before. And then at the last moment, it's as though the tail gives an involuntary twitch. And then the animals immediately notice that and go racing off away from the leopard. I don't know, it's interesting that they've evolved in that manner. Obviously, the uses of the tail outweigh its disadvantages of not having that degree of control. And a warm welcome to Sarah, who is watching and asking her questions on Twitter and would like to know what the difference is. There goes that tail again. What the difference is between a leopard and a cheetah. Brilliant question, one that is two animals that are very easily confused to people who are unfamiliar with them. So a leopard is built for stealth and strength. They've got very, very stocky bodies. Just have a look, Sarah. I know it's not the easiest thing to see, but try and have a look at the spots, particularly around his bottom and his back. They're not solid spots. They are what's known as rosettes. So they form, these spots sort of form a little ring around, ring-like pattern. And it's only around their legs and their face that they actually have solid spots, whereas cheetah have completely solid spots. Leopards have retractable claws because they utilize them for hunting and for climbing. They need to stay sharp and protected and out of the way. Whereas with cheetah, they need their claws for traction when they run. So their claws are semi-non-retractable and very often quite distinctly clear in their tracks. I'm going to show you a picture just to make what I've said easier. And the biggest defining feature of a cheetah, or one that I think most people are the most familiar with, is the tear marks that run down from the corner of their eyes. So this is a cheetah. Long limbs, claws at the tip, and then those dark marks that run down the side of the face. And the big reason why they have those is because, unlike leopards, cheetah are active during the day. They are not nocturnal cats. That is because they're smaller than all of the other cats in this area, big cats in this area. So they rather would hunt during the day when there's less competition. So those dark stripes actually absorb the glare of the sun and make it a bit easier for them to hunt. There's the solid spots. Now, if we flip over, just to give you a comparison of size, and that you can actually see the clearer difference in body structure. You see how long-legged and sort of thin and athletic-looking a cheetah is? It is so that it is capable of those bursts of speed. Whereas a leopard, much stockier, slightly shorter, but heavier, and more powerful. A cheetah would never be able to drag a kill up a tree in the same way that a leopard can. So a leopard is much, much heavier. And then, of course, just for comparison, you can see how much larger a lion is in terms of size and shape. And just last thing, because we can't see it as clearly on Tingana as I would like to be able to answer you properly, this is what I mean by the rosettes. You see how they're not solid spots? They're sort of a series of spots around a slightly discolored patch of fur. And no claws visible. So those are the big differences between leopards and cheetahs. In terms, physiologically, in terms of evolution, the cheetahs are a completely separate branch of the cat family. They do not fall under the Panthera heading. The Panthera cats are basically defined by their ability to roar, which cheetah absolutely do not do. And in fact, they make very uncat-like or sounds that we would never associate with big cats in Africa. They chirp like birds and they purr. But their best, I mean, my favorite call of a cheetah sort of goes, sounds nothing like what a big cat should sound like. They're very, very different. They tend to be much more retiring. They also occur in much smaller numbers in this particular area. It's hard if you're a cheetah to really get up to full speed in such thick vegetation. Ellie's have finally gone silent, but I know that Brent is sort of around the area where they have been calling. Let's find out if he could hear them and what he thinks might be happening.
So no sign of the Queen of Juma yet, but we are still on the prowl. And while we've been prowling, we have been keeping our eye open for edible plants. And we do have another one to show you. It's quite a nice one, very pretty one. There we go. You can see that purple. That purple isn't actually the flower, it's a leaf. Now, my thinking on this is that that leaf is probably, that color is to attract certain insects. And you can see the flowers, actually, that's a bit of flower there. They're white. Now, this is very similar to something you would find in your kitchen at home. This is Onycum onycum, the wild basil. So lovely. It smells slightly different to your normal basil that you would have in your kitchen, but it's definitely a basil. The smell, you can do that, and the taste as well. It is definitely basil. Very, very tasty. I personally like to use it with lamb when I'm cooking, but normally in the summer seasons, there's lots of them, and I've only seen three so far, but they've become very big bushes. And if I spot a bush while we're driving, I shall show it to you. Yum, 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 yum. So Jamie's just said she heard some elephants trumpeting and was wondering if I heard them. I think I'm a bit far at the moment from where Jamie is with the lovers, Tingana and Tundi. It would be nice to catch up with some ellies before the end of the drive there. Haven't seen any yet today. Lots of tracks all over the place. These basils got stuck on my palate. But while I try to deal with this basil issue, and it's not basil faulty, although his reincarnation in the name of James Hendry is wandering around on the reserve somewhere. But someone was wondering, oh, sorry. if we have any honeysuckle plants here. And yes, we do. Maybe not. I'm trying to think if I've seen any in Juma. I haven't, but they do occur in South Africa. Sorry, in South Africa. And there's two types. There's one that's a bush and one that's a creeper. So we do, and very beautiful flowers, quite similarly colored to this. Obviously the flower shapes are different, but we have a couple of species of honeysuckles, but they're generally in areas that have got slightly more rain, so closer to the mountains. So it's been a blast looking for flowers and attempting to look for big cats with you, but fortunately Jamie got those mating leopards, which is, I'm sure, provided you excitement. And I've just kept waffling on about all the different wildflowers. And I think Vim and I are together again on the Sunset Safari, so I think we're going to continue our search for edible plants and whatever else we might be able to find. But until the Sunset Safari, I'm sure you're quite sick of listening to me. So go enjoy the last few minutes with Jamie and the leopards.
We are still with our leopards. And despite my best Lionel Richie crooning and the mood lighting set by the dark cloudy sky and the green bushes, it has not inspired our leopards to move up from their position and to mate once again. In fact, the most movement we've had from Tingana is just flicking the flies around him. Generally quite common with leopards mating. So they'll mate quite a lot during the night and in the early hours of the morning. And as the morning starts to heat up, they start to slow down. Never mind, we will just have to wait for our sunset safari this afternoon. Hopefully they decide to stay in this general area and not disappear on us. We'll keep our fingers crossed and you'll have to join us then to find out what will happen. As always, a big thank you to Brian for his fantastic camera work, and of course a big thank you to the Thumb as well for joining us, as well as to our lovely ladies Kirsty and Rebecca in final control, and our tech team out and about and making sure everything flows smoothly, which, as you can imagine, is sometimes an absolutely enormous job. And most importantly, thank you to all of you for your questions and your comments that you feed through to us. We really appreciate them, and they make our drives so much more fun and entertaining for all of us. So have a wonderful day wherever you are in the world, and we're going to leave off with the last view of our leopards. Thank you.